I just kept wondering what Coach Spears was thinking to hear 3 silent hours of folks just tell him how good he was. I was wondering if he'd be able to drag his head in through the door this morning. You know what I mean? God is good, and so all the time. Amen. And so I was just thinking about that, and you know, we had the pep rally out there, and it's free Willie this and free Willie that. I mean, it's wonderful. But, you know, Coach Willie and I were praying in the back, and in my prayer I said, you know, when you come to think about it, Coach Spears or I haven't lost 1 ounce of blood to save 1 single person. There's only 1 man in history I know that shed his blood in order that the sins, our sin, could be forgiven, and that's Jesus Christ. And that's why we're here today, to worship and celebrate him. And Coach Spears had also prayed in his prayer. He said, if folks come to hear about Willie, he said, you're going to be disappointed. But if they come to hear about Jesus, you're going to be blessed. Amen? And that's why we're here. So welcome this morning. We're glad to have you. If you're our visitors, let me just say there's a few things that we need to do as a church, and that is to share just a few announcements. We have an administrative board and finance meeting. Normally it's on a Monday. It will be this Tuesday night, and we had to move it to Tuesday night because our worship team and myself will be at Teen Challenge tomorrow night at the men's campus on 98. And our worship team is going to be leading in worship, and I'll be preaching as well. So we had to move the administrative board meeting and the finance meeting Tuesday night. The times are there as well. Lisa, would you come forward? Lisa's going to come and share about a project that we're doing here at the church. And while she's going to do that, let me remind you, Nancy Leonard's nephew. Nancy, where are you? Nancy's in the back. You remember Chris Hankinson? He was the corrections officer that was paralyzed in the explosion of the jail cell. Well, Chris, and this is for the community, so this is for everyone. Saturday, we'll put this on our website and we'll get it out as well. But Saturday, October the 11th at 9 o'clock at the John R. Jones Sports Complex, that's at 555 East 9 Mile Road, they're having a fundraiser for him. And Chris will be traveling home. His brother is going to pick him up, bring him back, and he'll be coming in September the 23rd. No. I got all that wrong.
Ronnie is not picking him up. Ronnie is riding with him. Chris is driving.
He is driving his vehicle. Isn't that awesome? Wow. God has done wonderful, wonderful things. And also the rallies. Their daughter is home. You know, she was in Mexico when they had the storm to come in, and we didn't know if they, you know, were going to get out, and it wasn't a safe environment. But I was talking to Kathy this morning. I'm looking forward to hearing that wonderful story, because I know God had worked a great miracle in getting your daughter home. Amen. We'll give him thanks and praise for that. That is just tremendous. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I'll get to preaching.
Good morning. On behalf of Sisters in Service, I just wanted to remind our congregation about our apple tree project. We still have about 15 apples available. These represent children and youth in our church who we're trying to be a blessing to by purchasing clothing items for them. Today is the last Sunday to pick up an apple, so we encourage you to do that after the service. The tree is in the fellowship hall, so if you would go back there, take a look, take an apple, and buy the items that are listed there on the back. We would certainly appreciate that. We are also taking donations. If you don't feel like you're able to purchase an apple and take on the full responsibility, we're certainly willing to take donations for that. Checks can be made payable to the church, and just notate Apple Tree Project on that. We are asking for all of the items to be brought back to the church by October 5th, and they can be given to any Sisters in Service member. If real quick, if you're in Sisters in Service, if you would stand up real quick and just so people can see you. If you have any questions about the project, you can ask any of these ladies, and if you have items to turn in, you can turn those in as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. If you would, continue to pray for Jamie Broxson, of course, is our choir director. Her son, Cameron, baby, got into some chewable children's Tylenol and thought those were gummy kind of, and he ate a whole bunch of them before they realized what it was, and excuse me, he's in the hospital. He's fine, but he's going to be in there for a day or two until they can get this stuff out of his system. And if you would pray for Jamie and for Cameron and Danny, and then Jamie is not going to be able to lead us this morning, and she was also going to sing a duet with Kevin Lee. And I am really sorry you're going to miss that. You'll have to come back to hear them. But Kevin's going to sing solo, and he has a beautiful voice. And I'm assuming Dr. Potter is going to lead our choir this morning as well. So we got it all handled. God is good. Okay, all the time. I step into that all the time. Amen. Also, if the children will, go out to children's church. If the children have these bags, as you exit, if you would leave them on the front pew, and as you go out the door, these aren't for you to take home. They're to stay here and to have neat little stuff and crayons and all kind of stuff in there. So make sure that we get those back. We certainly would appreciate it. Make sure after the service, if your children goes to children's church, that you go pick them up. If you don't, we jack them up on Mountain Dew and send them home with a puppy. So just wanted to let you know that ahead of time. The other thing that we'll do in our service, be the last announcement, is that we're going to receive an offering this morning because our congregation just loves to give. And I mean that. They really do. If you are our guest this morning, the offering that we're going to take is for our congregation. We have to receive that. If you'd like to give, that's fine. Feel please, but don't feel any obligation whatsoever when that offering plate comes by that you have to put something in it. If you are our guest this morning and you would like to give, there are some baskets that you'll see. These baskets are on both sides of the altar table. There are two baskets as you leave. If you would like to give a donation, this money helps our church pay for the pregame meals that we provide these football players. So if you are our guest this morning, you can use this if you'd like to give, and that money goes in. You can either make it out to the quarterback club if you have a check. You can make it out to Myrtle Grove United Methodist or cash or whatever, and that money will go to help with the feeding the pregame meals for our boys. All right, are you ready to get started? Yeah. Amen. Me too. I'm tired of announcements. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Color guard, attention. Please rise for the presentation of the colors. Troop salute. Those not in uniform, please place your right hand over your heart. Color guard, advance. Color guard, halt. Color guard, cross the colors. Very good. Color guard, post the flag of the United States of America. Post the Christian flag.
Please recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please recite the pledge to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag. My Savior, Jesus Christ, stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe. Please recite the pledge to the Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, to the holy word. I make a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and will hide its word in my heart that I might not sin against God. 2. American Heritage Girls Oath. I promise to love God, cherish my family, honor my country, and serve in my community.
Color guard, honor your colors. Color guard, return to your ranks. Please join us in prayer.
Lord, in the morning, I start each day by taking a moment to bow and pray. I start with thanks and then give praise for all your kind and loving ways. Today, if sunshine turns to rain, if a dark cloud brings some pain, I won't doubt or hide in fear, for you, my God, are always near. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. And as our worship team comes to lead us in morning worship, I want to give a special thanks to Paul Marini. Paul is in the back, and Paul is with 8730am.com. He live streams all the our football games here of Escambia County. Did an excellent job yesterday interviewing one of the gentleman who sits on the school board, and we appreciate that. What did I say, county? Let me explain. When I say Escambia County, I lived in Chilton County for 6 years, and it was Chilton County High School. And there you go. So if I say Escambia County, just know that I'm dumb, so we'll get past it. Escambia High School. Anyway, Paul, we're grateful that you're here. He's live streaming this service today. Paul, how many viewers do we have out there? I want to go up and say, if you'll just put your hand on the screen. No, I can't do that. Can I? Paul, how many we have?
Right now we're at 575.
Isn't that awesome? We appreciate that. Amen. Amen. Would you stand? Would you stand?
Y'all ready to worship the Lord this morning?
Yeah.
That's about like 48%. Y'all ready to worship the Lord this morning?
Yeah.
I don't know what brought you here today, but I want you to know something. If you're here, God's here to meet with you today. You might have your reasons, but God has his reason, which is he wants him to know you. And so today, as we worship, I want you to know that the Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name, I'm there with them. So you can't escape from God being here today. You are here in his presence. And it's up to you whether or not you're going to have an open heart to hear his word to you. And a great place to start is singing with us and worshiping with us. The words will be up on the screen. If you don't know the song, you'll get it pretty quick. Amen.
Sing, oh you sinners, see
remain standing in our 8:30 service. We have a traditional worship service here at Myrtle Grove. The 11 o'clock is our contemporary, in which you've heard our band. And so at 12:30, it's more traditional, but it is still spirit-filled because we serve a God that is a God that is alive. Amen? Amen. Jesus Christ, though He died, He rose again on the third day. Jesus is alive and He is with us. In our church, it has been our history, and especially in the traditional setting, to recite creeds. Now, these creeds have been passed down from generation to generation, and during times when the church was in great persecution and there was no printed material, Christian creeds were passed down to children, to children, to children, in order that the people of God would not forget the God who had delivered them out of bondage and the God that still delivers them today. And so we have what we call our affirmation of faith. There are a couple of words here that may be unfamiliar. In our creed, it says that we believe that Jesus will come to judge the quick and the dead. The quick simply means not those who, if you have arthritis and you say, well, I'm going to escape Jesus' judgment because I'm not quick, that's not it. Quick simply means living. We also would say, I believe in the Holy Spirit and the Holy Catholic Church. It's not the Roman Catholic Church. It's a small C. Catholic means what? Universal. And so when we say we believe in the Holy Universal Catholic Church, which the church that we're all a part of, doesn't matter if you're Methodist or Baptist or Pentecostal, Lutheran or Catholic, if Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior and you've accepted Him and He has forgiven you of your sins, you are a part of the body of Christ. And we are all the body of Christ. So would you join together as we recite this historic confession of our Christian faith, followed by the Gloria Patri. Now, the first time I saw that, I thought it was Sandy Patty's sister had come to sing. But you'll catch on real quick. Here we go. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Before you're seated, would you just turn to a neighbor and welcome one another out in God's house? Just wherever you're standing, turn and greet one another. Yeah, in a minute. Go ahead. Yeah, by the time you get over there, give us a few seconds. I will need it, yes. The hymns, you can do it from here. And if you'll cut the red mic on, would be good.
Thank you. We have our sound booth are working overtime right now. We have so much going on, but they're doing a great job. During our worship service, too, in the 8:30 service, our traditional service, and I'm just telling you that simply because if you are attending church somewhere, please continue to go. Support your church. Support the ministry. If you're not attending somewhere and if there's something that we do here that you like, we would love for you to come back and join with us and be a part of our family. We sang, I'm so glad to be a part of the family of God. And that's what we are here. And what we feel like we are trying to accomplish in our community is to build a community church to where you can come and feel like you are part of family. That when you come into this worship service, that you've come home. That you fit, and that that you're welcome, and we do welcome you. During our time of in our 8:30 service, we'll always open it up to where if someone has a testimony they'd like to share. Now, we're not talking about giving your whole life story. You know, a testimony that can maybe consist of at least, you know, 10, 15, 20 seconds. I know how difficult it was to do a testimony in 3 minutes at the board meeting the other night. And I just looked, wow, you know, it goes real. But when you're listening, it goes by a lot slower than talking. So just keep that in mind. If someone here would just like to stand up and just praise God, give God some glory for what he's done in your life. Anyone, quickly. Anyone, quickly. Yes, Bill. And if you would, if you want to give God glory, let's give him all the glory we can on this side. And then I don't want to have to run over there. Okay? So y'all get it together. All right? And then we're going to go to here next, and then I go to here next, and then there last. Thank you.
I just want to praise God for our daughter. She was in Cabo last Sunday, supposed to fly out. Hurricane Odile or whatever it was, had started out as a Cat 4, was a Cat 3 by the time they hit, but it was a direct hit. And, you know, we see sometimes get aggravated with our government and FEMA and all that, folks. You have no clue compared to being in a foreign country in a place that is completely inaccessible. You can't drive there to see them. It's very, very limited communication. It was utter agony. But thanks and praise be to God. They were rescued early Thursday morning. Yes, I believe early Thursday morning. Got on a plane and were told, you're going to California, but we can't tell you where. And once they got in the air, they were told they're home. She lives in Kansas right now, and she'd kind of complained a little bit because she'd moved from Denver to Kansas about how slow Kansas was. So anyway, Friday when they were home, I said, I bet Kansas has never looked so good. So,
yeah. I bet when she was in Mexico, she said, this ain't Kansas either. Yeah. Anyone else want to give God some glory on this side right here? Okay, wonderful. Thank you.
Last year, a couple weeks before Christmas, my mom was diagnosed with breast cancer. She is now not cancer-free, but it hasn't grown back. Chemo has worked, and she's in remission, and she's doing great. And the doctors are like, I can't believe how good she's doing. It's awesome.
Amen. Praise God. Anyone else?
All right, I think we all know the song Amazing Grace. I've been blind for 4 weeks again, and just like I said, I've been blind, now I can see again. So I'm glad he got my glasses to me.
Amen, she got some glasses back. Give the Lord some praise for some glasses. Anyone else right through here? Yes, ma'am.
I just want you to know the women are alive and well in this church. We had almost 100 ladies here yesterday. And that was the most blessing. I'm telling you that Jackie Slaughter, she spoke for us. And ladies, if you were not here, you missed it. It was a wonderful, wonderful day. And I just want to let you know that the men, we're proud of you men, but we're also proud of our ladies.
Amen. Well, us men been...
We've been trying to play catch up to you ladies for a long time, I can tell you. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to thank the Lord for our good leadership, for Pastor Riley, Angie, and Patrick. A few weeks ago, I passed at my church on the west side that had been closed for lack of leadership. And it was so sad to see the empty parking lot. And I thank God for these people here.
Appreciate that. I'll go on. That wasn't 3 hours worth, but I'll take it. Anybody want to give the Lord some praise on this side? Yes, in the back. You could have run halfway.
My praise is for Chris.
Yes.
Pastor Riley said he was paralyzed in the explosion at the jail. He had one broken shoulder, one shattered shoulder, 7 broken ribs, a broken pelvis. He is coming home, and we are just grateful that he is with us, and it is all by God's glory, because technically he should have died twice.
Yes, that's right. Amen. Anyone else? Wonderful. Quick prayer request. I don't need a long history. Just pray for me. Arthur sitting in, or Bertha, or yes, quickly.
My neighbor, he passed away. I want to pray for him.
Okay, pray for death. What's their name?
Miller.
Miller family. Anyone else? Ron Ayers is with us. Ron, good to see you. Had some surgery for 28 years in the United Methodist Church. I'm ordained elder in the Methodist Church. Angie's mom and her dad are both elders in the Methodist Church. Her brother is an elder in the Methodist Church. Angie preaches women's conferences all over the Alabama West Florida Conference. Our family all together have been in ministry probably representing over 200 to 250 years. And there we have a lot more in the family, uncles and cousins and aunts and nephews, all are in ministry serving somewhere. And I said all that to say, in 28 years and in pastoring several churches, that I can tell you, and I'm not just saying it because you're in this church, but I say it about the people in this area. I have met some of the most genuine people in this area. And I'm not talking about folks that have a whole lot, because we don't have a whole lot. And I've met a lot of folks that don't have a whole lot. You can enjoy life. You can love people. I mean, you can have a great life without having a whole lot. I've seen that already.
Amen.
Because it's about the content and the character of a person's heart that really matters. And people in this area are just genuine. People in this church just genuinely love one another. I've seen it in the Catholic Church. I go down and preach there once every other year. We have a combined worship service with the Catholic Church. And I've gotten to know those brothers and sisters. And through this experience that we've had together as a community in the last month or so, I've come to get to know another group of people, and that is the Gator Nation. And people on Facebook and social media, and little did we know how God would intertwine and weave our lives together. And I'm standing on tiptoes of anticipation and excitement to see where God's going to carry that, Coach. I really am, because I believe that God is at work in the midst of all of it. In just a few minutes, Kevin Lee is going to come and sing for us, and Kevin has a beautiful voice. The next word that you'll hear after Kevin will be that of Coach Willie Spears. He's my brother in Christ. He is a beloved leader in this community. And we know that God has great things in store for Coach Willie, for his wife, and for his two children, and for extended family, and for these young men who've come to know and respect you as a leader,
and a father figure in their life. And so, Coach, as soon as Kevin gets through, it's yours. Would you let Willie Spears know how much you love and appreciate him? Kevin?
You're not enough. Oh, 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 oh. I've been the one to try and say I'll overcome by my own strength. I've been the one to fall apart and start to question who you are. You're the one who conquers giants. You're the one who calls out kings. You shut the mouths of lions. You tell the dead to breathe. You're the one who walks through fire. You take the orphan's hand. You are the one Messiah. You are I am. I've been the one to believe that where I am, you cannot reach. You're the one who conquers giants. You're the one who calls out kings. You shut the mouths of lions. You tell the dead to breathe. You're the one who walks through fire. You take the orphan's hand. You are the one Messiah. You are I am. You are I am. The veil is torn, and now the same one, the very same one that brought the sun back to life.
Hallelujah, he lives in me.
Hallelujah,
he lives in me.
He lives in me. Shut the mouths of lions. You tell the dead to breathe. You're the one who walks through fire. You take the orphan's hand. You are the one Messiah. You are I am. You are I am.
Hallelujah. Amen. I'll preach if you want me to now. I can do it.
If I knew he was going to sing that good, I would have prepared another sermon.
All right.
You can go ahead and play that video if you'll click that link. The link before that one. Go back to the very beginning. Man, y'all give him another hand. He can sing. It may not play, but if you would click those words, transforming your life. If you won't, that's no problem. Okay, would y'all give a hand to the choir, the band, and to Kevin? Unbelievable. It's so good to be here with you all today. Many of you have never seen me in this capacity. I'm blessed to be gifted in different areas. I'm not really, really good at any of them, but God has given me a little bit in a lot of different areas. And today, we're going to preach. So I want you guys to understand is when I was probably 23, 24, I think my wife and I were dating a young man who was on my football team. I was a head JV coach, and he was in my classroom, and I was his youth pastor. And he got up to introduce me, and he said, and he stuttered. So it was kind of funny, but it was so sincere. He said, Coach Spears is, he said, the thing about Coach Spears, he said, you know, he a preacher, and he a coach, and he a teacher, but he like the same at the same time, but he different, but he the same. Introducing Coach Spears, that's what he did. And so for me, that was a great compliment. He was saying that the same guy he sees on the field, in the classroom, in the pulpit, is the same. I asked him about it afterwards. He was like, I didn't tell the whole truth, because you be going off at practice. I didn't want to tell him that. But it's an honor to be here today with your great pastor, Pastor Riley, his beautiful wife, Angie. Would you give United Grove Methodist a hand, please? Myrtle Grove United Methodist has done so much for this community and has embraced us before we had this partnership of coach and quarterback club president. It's been great for us, and I've been very blessed. You could imagine, I know many of you are so concerned about what's going on with us, and I don't say this lightly, but I just want to let you know it's not a big deal. You know, I don't major in minors. My wife can tell you that. You heard testimonies of people being in remission of cancer, and testimony of people being blind, and testimony of people having surgery. We didn't have surgery. We don't have cancer, okay? God has saw provision for us to do whatever he's doing. He's God. I gave him my life a long time ago so he can do whatever he want with it. So it's really not that big a deal. What's a big deal is where our soul resides when we leave this earth. And so as you're praying, I want you to know, I want you to continue to pray, but I'm so thankful to have a beautiful woman. I mean, she fine, Pastor. I mean, she off the chain. Yeah. Would y'all please give my wife a hand? This has been very difficult for her. Very blessed. I'm very blessed. And so good to see a couple of our players here this morning. And it's good to see Elder Walker. He and I was serving the same pulpit at East Hill Church of God in Christ when we first moved to the area. And so many of you, thank you for coming. But like I said, when Pastor Riley and I was praying, if you came to see Willie Spears, we hope you're greatly disappointed. God is going to do his thing this morning. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you right now just asking that you speak to us. People often ask, how does God speak? Does he speak through the clouds? Is it an audible voice? How does the Lord speak? Well, you said, how can they hear unless they have a preacher? And how can he preach unless he be sent? So we just ask this morning that you use the preacher, Father, the willing vessel that's not good enough to be used by you, but somehow you seem to take mess and trash and get the glory out of it. So, Father, we pray this morning that you would speak to our individual needs and that you would give us the courage to apply the message to our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I've had a topic this morning. The topic will be unity, coming together as one. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Psalm chapter 133, or the 133rd number of the Psalm. Those of you who are over the age of 40, you're turning in your Bible. You young people, you could turn in your tablet or your phone or whatever you got. I told my wife this morning, I said, I'm going to preach my first sermon without my actual Bible on the podium or the pulpit. And she said, you going to be okay? I said, well, for the last 5 years, I haven't really used the Bible. But in my church where I grew up, there's a lady named Mother Miller. She's 92 years old. If you don't have on a tie and you don't have that King James Version Bible, when you go up there, you're going to get slapped right in the face, a holy slap. Right when you get out the pulpit. I told a joke one time, and I thought it was so appropriate for the message. When I finished, she said, come here, baby. I said, yes, ma'am. She said,
come here, baby. I said, I'm right here. You just slapped me in my face. I'm here. She said, Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's all you need to say. And I was thinking in my mind, but it gave me 30 minutes. That take like 30 seconds. But her point was, every time you get in the pulpit, you need to make sure you go by the cross. And so as you turn your electronic device or your Bible, I hope you have found the 133rd number of the psalm. Now, this psalm was written by David, okay? David, we know David's greatest accomplishment when he defeated Goliath. And we know his greatest failure when he made a mistake and he took Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, and he was with her. But we don't know a lot about him in between. I challenge you when you read the Bible to learn about the person who's writing it. That way you can get a better understanding of where they're coming from when they're writing it. David was a great man. My middle name is David. I love David. The Bible says he's a man after God's own heart. That's what the Bible says. But David had a lot of issues. A lot of people don't realize David had 7 wives and many concubines. David had 25 plus sons. David had a lot of baby mamas, if you will. David was very diligent in his job as king. He was very good at it. He was anointed and he waited till the time was right, until God said so, to become what God had ordained him to be. David had great gifts. He was very physical with his hands. He was handsome. He was very good when it came to music and playing instruments. But David did not understand the most important ministry in his life, and that was his family. David neglected his family. One of his sons, Absalom, even tried to kill him. David had a better relationship with his best friend, Jonathan, than he did with his very own flesh and blood. Many times in ministry and even in coaching, we're so diligent to help everybody but our very own families. So it's good today that we are here together, because David tells us that it's good when we dwell together. I'm going to read from 3 different versions. King James Version is what I grew up on. The New International Version is what I was introduced to when I went to college. And when I got very involved with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, I was introduced to the Holman Christian Standard Bible. So we're going to read all 3 very short verses. Psalm 133:1, it says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. How good and how pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. How good and how pleasant it is when brothers live together in harmony. My mother once was giving me a compliment, so I thought. I was probably 26, about 10 years ago, and she says, David, she calls me David. She said, look, David, you're doing so good with those boys in football. She had found out that I had bought a young man some cleats who didn't have any, and any coach would tell you, Coach Sam Waters, who coached Little League for years and not coaching at Scambia, you have to do those things when families can't afford it. So she was bragging on me. I'm so proud of you. And I heard you on the phone, that one boy, you paid for his ACT test. I said, yes, ma'am. I did, yes, ma'am. And she said, you help those boys with their homework, and you stay after school all day. I said, yes, ma'am. Mama, I just feel that's what God want me to do. Mama, you know, I'm just trying to do the right thing the way I was raised. She said, I wish you would spend that time and energy on your own family. I said, ma'am. She said, your cousin DeVarian, he in the streets. He won't act right. He won't do right. He getting in trouble. He right here carrying a gun. He out there smoking. He drinking. He acting a fool. And you won't have any time for him. Maybe if he played on your football team, you would pay more attention to him. And that hurt me to my core, because she was 100% right. A lot of times we neglect the people that are right there in our own household. It's very sad. It's unfortunate that we would neglect the first ministry God gave us so we can do for other people. There's nothing wrong with doing for others. But like the story of the Good Samaritan, don't be so busy going to ministry that you step right over ministry on your way. Unity, the definition of unity. There are many definitions. One is the state of being one, oneness, coming together. I'll give you a good example. Alabama fans were happy yesterday. Let me tell you something about preachers that you may not know. Preachers are not perfect, all right? Preachers have some issues. We had the rally right out here, and Pastor Miller, who Pastor Riley had just met earlier that day. We were all in a meeting, me, Pastor Riley, Pastor Miller, and Pastor Lentini. And through this whole process, I sought wisdom from men of God. Our very own chaplain, Bob Gavoni, was very influential and through this whole process with me. So we had a meeting that morning. He met Pastor Miller, thought he was a great man of God, the pastor of Warrenton First Baptist. And after Pastor Miller prayed, many of you didn't catch this, after he prayed in front of all those people at that rally, he said, War Eagle. Now, he said that. Somebody said, blasphemy. Come on, relax, relax. Okay, right after he prayed, Pastor Riley got the mic. I mean, right after he said, in the name of Jesus, amen, Roar Eagle. He got the mic, Roll Tide. Thank y'all so much for coming tonight. We appreciate it. I said, wow. Father, pray for those men. They both need help. To express what unity is, all you have to see is an Alabama fan. Some may say they crazy. Some may say they're passionate. Realists may say they crazy. There's something about an Alabama fan. Maybe it's because there are no pro teams in the state of Alabama. Maybe it's because Alabama this big. I don't know what the reason is, but people love Alabama. Well, that's an example of unity. All of a sudden, these Florida State fans have come out of the closet. They come out, I mean, all of a sudden, they everywhere. Florida, I love Florida State. Where is it at? Oh, it's in Jacksonville. Ain't it? It's in Jacksonville, Orlando. No, Tallahassee. Yeah, I love Florida State. They have no clue. But you can see now that they've won, everybody's excited. When I was younger, I would take Kenneth with me, KD, my youngest son, my son. And I would speak at these Fellowship of Christian Athletes rallies called FCA Game Day. And it would be in before games at Florida State. And so KD was 3-4 years old. He was with me. He would see the whole crowd doing this. He would do it too. He would be like, what are they doing? I said, I think all their arms messed up. So they all stretching at the same time, I guess. Stretching in unison. It's so beautiful. But that was an example of unity, an example of people coming together. The thing about that that's so important is the head coach, Coach Fisher, and Coach Saban, they can't go around and be at every place at one time. So the fans represent that school when the coach can't be there. What people don't understand about unity is that we're all unified with something, whether we want to be or not. It may be because of our gender or our race or our religious background or where we were born, but it's something that we're connected with. As a sports fan, you're not ashamed on Saturday to let everybody know how much you love your team. But what about during the week? Do people know how much you love your God? Do they know how much you love your family? Or is it only about you showing the expression that's popular at the time? As a body of believers, we must spread the good news of Jesus because he is not here anymore to do that. On November 13th, right at Pensacola Bay Center, Casting Crowns will be there. So great band. They do a phenomenal job of worshiping God through song. Casting Crowns has a song called If We Are the Body. In the chorus it says, but if we are the body, if we are his body, why aren't his hands reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them that there is a way, and that way is Jesus? You have to, I have to show people what Jesus looks like because many of them don't know him for themselves. See, when somebody's hurting, we can't say, I wish Pastor Riley would come by here because that man needs a ride. No, you have a vehicle. You give him a ride. It's a shame that we've gotten so uppity we can't visit a laundromat anymore. We forgot when we had a raggedy car because now we finally got a good car. We forgot when we was on a minute plan with our cell phone because now we got a smartphone and we got a real plan. It's so easy to forget where we've come from. Well, let me be the first to tell you from personal experience. One day you can have a job and the next day you can be unemployed. I tell our players all the time that you need to get everything you can out of today because tomorrow is not promised to you. My wife and I grew up in a trailer, not the same trailer, that would be nasty. She grew up in a little part of town called Glenwood, okay? Didn't they just move your trailer a few years ago? A little raggedy, little white trailer, was ugly too. Our trailer was nice. It was a single wide, just like hers, but it was on the other side of town. And I say that to say that we were very blessed since we've been married. We first got married, we lived in a little small apartment. Then we got a house, and it seemed like every time we moved, God blessed us with a bigger house. Now, we wake up all the time, we look at each other and say, how in the world did God do this? How in the world did this happen? We don't know, we really don't. But see, we understand that it's all about him and not about us. That what we have doesn't tell us who we are. That God can take us where he wants us and he can take us back if he would like. If you study the life of Paul, Paul said, I've had it all. I've been up here and I've been down here, and through all things I can give God glory. Through all things. So what I'm trying to get you to understand, it's important that we do what Christ would do if he was here. He's not here. So you should be witnessing on your job. He's not here. So you should be witnessing in the school. He's not here. So you should be loving those people in your family. The ones that you believe don't deserve love. The ones that you believe don't deserve forgiveness. The ones that you believe have done so many heinous things that they don't deserve a second opportunity. I'm so glad that God doesn't look at us that way. In the book of Romans, Paul writes, Romans chapter 12, verse 4 and 5, and you don't have to turn, we're going to run through these pretty quick. It says, for just as each of us has one body with many members, these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs all to the others. In other words, your body is made up of many members. Your knee and your fingers have different jobs. Your calf and your bicep have different activities and different functions. Of course, your brain and your feet have different functions. Many times in church, we find everybody wants to be the head. Don't have to say amen, pastor, just stay seated. Many times, every committee wants to be in charge. Every committee wants this and want that. And everyone must understand that we all have different jobs to do. Everyone can't be the mouthpiece. Everyone can't be the foot. You have to work in your capacity. And if the body is working together, it will function the way it's supposed to. But if the body works against each other, it'll be like a person walking around hitting themselves in the head. You would say, what's wrong with that person? And people will say that about your church. What's wrong with that church if they can't get along? If this department doesn't gel well with that department? See, we're many members, but we're one body. At a school board hearing on Tuesday night, very emotional time, something I would never forget. Mr. Boone, who's here. Y'all give Mr. Boone a hand. Mr. Boone is one of the school board members. Mr. Boone realized that he's not the whole body of the school board, but he's one member of the body. Okay? He figured, I got to do what I believe is right. I can't be concerned about the rest of the body. It's the same in your job. Maybe God hasn't elevated you to manager because you haven't done a good job where he's already placed you. Maybe God hadn't blessed you with another child because you haven't done a good job raising the one he already gave you. Maybe God haven't blessed you with more money because you haven't been faithful with the little bit that he's already blessed you with. Many times we want more and we're not faithful with the little bit that we have. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12, for as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. As I said before, your most important ministry is your family. Think about your family right now. If your mother's still living or your father, think about your sister, your brother. I remember I was here one Sunday, Pastor, and Linda Danks was sitting over there with her father. And I met her father and I shook his hand and we talked. And a few weeks later, he passed away. See, we don't know when our last breath will be taken. My mother get on my nerves. I'm just being honest with you. She is a handful, but she is my mother. See, I don't have another mother. That's the only mother that God gave me. So it doesn't matter if we get along or not. At the end of the day, she is my mother. So I can't go a long time without speaking to her because that's not the right thing to do, whether I want to or not. Family is so important. We often tell the players that family is an acronym. Forget about me, I love you. In other words, it's not what I want, it's what's best for you. Forget about me, I love you. That's what family is. Family is, we only have a little bit of food, so I'm gonna give it to my children before I eat. Family is, you know what, we don't have a lot of money, but my wife wants this, I can hold off on what I want. Family is doing for others. God gave you that husband. I know he's a knucklehead, but that's what God gave you. God gave you those wild children. Yeah, God gave you that homosexual uncle. And see, that's a tough thing to talk about in church. I spoke in a prison one time, and a man who was a homosexual, he came up to me afterwards and asked for prayer. And he hugged my neck. He was very feminine. And I hugged him hard. I want him to realize, listen, bro, I'm a child of the Most High God. I'm not intimidated by you or afraid of what you're going through right now. The God I serve is bigger than you and your situation. And he whispered in my ear, he said, I go home in 8 days. Please pray for me. I don't want my mother to see me like this. See, there's something in all of us that wants to be more like Christ. God gave you that lying brother. I know every time he opened his mouth, he lied. He got on a red shirt. You say, nice red shirt. He said, this shirt blue. You say, no, Johnny, your shirt red. No, it's blue. No, you're trying to trick me. He can't help but lie. I had a player like that once. He broke in somebody's car and stole all the change out of the ashtray. Had the change in his pocket. The police came by the facility in Jefferson County, and he walking, ching, 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 ching. The police officer said, sir, I think one of your players stole some change out of this lady's car. If he just give it back, we'll be okay. He said, he was moving around too much to have his lie be straight. I ain't even doing that, coach. I ain't even doing that. I say, stop moving. They can hear the change. Stand still. The evidence is talking. Just be quiet. My point is, if that's your family, that's still your family. Right. See, sometimes we like to pick and choose. I like to hang out with this member of the family because they got a nice house. Or they believe the same things I believe. Or they don't drink. Or they don't curse. Or they don't do. That's still your family. You need to love on your family. Many of us are more friendly to strangers than we are to our very own family. If I came to your house, you could be going off on your wife. You listen to me. Hold up with the doorbell. Oh, hey, coach, how you doing? Come on in. You know my lovely wife. Would you like something to eat? Can I get you something to drink? You were just going off on your wife. Now you're so friendly. We treat strangers like they treat us at Chick-fil-A. You go to Chick-fil-A, they say, my pleasure. No matter what you say, I say thank you like 30 times on purpose. Hey, can I get a thank you? My pleasure. I would like to thank you. My pleasure. I say, you know your hair looked messed up today, but thank you. My pleasure. The people at Chick-fil-A, they have it down pat to make you feel welcome, to make you feel good. Many of us, unfortunately, have been nicer to Willie Spears than we have to our own family. Do you realize that God revealed to me that some of you have shared intimate feelings with me that you haven't shared with your own family? That you told me that you are thankful that God used me in your son's life. You told me that you love me. You haven't even known me that long. And I appreciate it. But God revealed to me that some of you have not even told your own family that you love them. You prepared a speech to let the whole world know how much Willie Spears means to this community. Have you prepared a speech to let your mother know how much she means to you? Have you taken the time to write down how much your brother, your sister, your son, your daughter means to you? Is God going to have to manufacture a tragedy for you to express your feelings to your loved one? See, Pastor said, how does it feel to have 3 hours of people telling you how good you are? Well, it felt like a funeral. It felt like God was saying, you know, I'm going to take you home in a couple weeks, so I want you to know how everybody loves you. Yeah. Then the one guy got up there and said something bad, and I was like, woo, good, one of y'all. It's not my funeral. He was paid. He was obviously paid. That wasn't even his suit. It didn't even fit right. Many of us have a member of our family that we need to express our love to. Wouldn't you agree? Yes. Think about this. Some of us, I'm just going to be honest with you, need to forgive somebody in our family. That father did a heinous thing many years ago, and we still haven't forgiven him. That sister took your boyfriend in high school. Y'all both 53, 55 years old. He don't even have a job, right? You should be thankful. Garth Brooks had a song that says, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Let it go. You cannot accept Christ's forgiveness if you have not forgiven others. It's impossible. You can't hold on to unforgiveness and at the same time receive God's forgiveness. It's impossible. God wants us to forgive our family. I know what they said was bad. I know. I know what they did was horrible. You say, coach, you don't understand. I probably don't. But I know that you need God's forgiveness. And you can't get it if you don't forgive them. So in unity, we want to make sure that we do what we have to do to love our very own family. See, sometimes some of us are a little uppity. We got us a good job. We got some benefits. Now we go to the dentist twice a year. We made it. Well, we've arrived. What I'm realizing in life is it doesn't matter None of us are special. None of us are all that without him. See, it's not what you know, it's who you know. You ever heard that? It's not what you know, it's who you know. I've been getting these calls about these jobs, and I'm just going to be honest with y'all. I'm just believing God going to work a miracle out for me to go back to Escambia. I really don't know how he's going to do it. But I'm just being honest. I mean, my faith is a little weird. I'm just telling you, I can give you an example. I just got a weird faith. So every time somebody calls, I say, well, I got a job. Well, I heard you got fired. Well, stop listening to the devil. I got a job. So, but it's not what you know, it's who you know. People say it all the time. And when it's time to get a job, you always want to pull out the big guns. You want to tell everybody who you know. I've done this, you know. See, since this job, I've talked to Emmitt Smith a few times. I've talked to Trent a bunch. Matter of fact, not because of this job, but I've talked to Deion Sanders on the phone several times, and I've talked to Dwight Thomas, who coached at Escambia. And when you're going to get a job, you want to name drop. Let them know who you know. You want to tell them, you know, I know this person. You want to put these people on your resume. God convicted me once and said, why don't you just put my name on your resume? See, all those people you bragging about knowing, I made them. I made them from scratch. They ain't nobody. And the things they accomplished, if it weren't for me, they couldn't even tie their shoe. They couldn't even blink their eye. So instead of trying to figure out who do you know that's big time, you know me. I'm big time. The Lord said, I created the heavens and the earth. I took the stars and I put them in a socket. The Milky Way, I did that. The stars and the planets, I put them in the right order. You seen that one time I made the whole ocean stand up? Not in the Bible, but a few years ago. Yeah, tsunami, that was me. I can do it. Remember Ivan in Pensacola? That was me. A couple months ago, I broke the rose in half. Boom, just like that. I made it snow in Pensacola. I'm God Almighty. And so what I realize is it's not who you know. It's not what you know. It's who you know. So the question is, do you know him? That's the question. Do you know him? Not his name. Not his bio. So you can go on Wikipedia and find everything out about somebody. You may know that his mother name was Mary and he was born in a manger and he died and rose on the third day. But do you know him? See, I was at this hair salon and the lady, she did my wife's hair a little while ago. Look good, baby. And I had to go meet Miss Shannon actually there. She wanted some stuff to have to do with all this stuff we're going through. And I was like, where is that at? And it was on Cervantes, all right? Not the safest of neighborhoods. If you're gonna witness, start in Perdido and work your way there. But I knocked on the door and actually Miss Shannon was sitting on one of those big dryer things and some lady was praying for her when I walked in. And so she didn't see me. So the lady that owns the shop, Miss Raynell, she said, can I help you? And me being the clown that I am, I said, yeah, can I get a finger wave? I want a finger wave right here. And if you could, I know I don't have a lot of hair, but if you could kind of braid this right here. And she looked at me, she said, are you serious? And I wished for my wife, yes, ma'am, just tell me how much it's gonna cost. So I was talking to her and she was blocking the door. Like she wouldn't let me in. I kept looking around. I said, ma'am, could you? She said, we don't do that here. I said, ma'am, if you just name it, we don't do that. You probably need to go down the street to one of them other shops. I said, ma'am, please, if you could just put me on one of them things. And she was kind of looking and she was trying to be nice. You could tell she's a Christian. She was like, I know I'm saved, but ooh. Well, the reason she wouldn't let me in is because she did not know me. Christ is not going to let us into heaven if he doesn't know us. It doesn't matter if we know about him. We have to know him. I'm realizing in my life that I'm nothing without him. Nothing at all. I was speaking in Alabama, at Alabama State University in 2009 in the famed Acadome. There are 3,000 eighth graders here, plus administrators and teachers. And the lady was reading my bio. And I'm sitting there like, ooh, who is she reading about? Well, I sound pretty good. She started naming all this stuff. I said, yes, me, I'm the man. And it was like God whispered in my ear, I ain't gonna tell them that it took you 12 times to pass the teacher test. 12 times, you can't be that smart. You're not the brightest in the pack. You understand that, don't you? I'm like, no, I'm listening to her, not you, listen to her. Then the Lord started reminding me of all my shortcomings. Yeah. Of how before I became a head football coach, I had applied for 20 jobs and didn't get any of them. He started reminding me of all my good is him and all my bad is me. He started reminding me that every time I stepped out on my own, I failed. When I stepped out with him, my failure was success because it was ordained by him. See, some of you may remember, some of you people a little bit older, may remember the Rat Pack. Y'all remember the Rat Pack? Yeah, the old Rat Pack. I know you remember, Pastor Riley. I know you remember.
I know. Don't start singing. Now, if I ask you before I show this photo, who was Peter Lawford and who was Joey Bishop, many of you may not know. You know Dean Martin, you know Frank Sinatra, you know Sammy Davis. But those other two guys, nobody know them. You sports fans, if I said, who is B.J. Armstrong and who is Bill Cartwright? Some of you may say, I don't know who that is. Well, they were on the roster with Michael Jordan when he won his first three championships. See, what we got to realize is many of us, we got to be around the right folk in order to be anything. See, me, I'm nothing by myself. But when I stand next to Jesus, when I stand next to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I'm somebody. When I walk away from them, I'm nobody. Many of you may remember the Beatles. You remember the Beatles? But who was George Harrison? Now, some of you may know who that is, but many of you don't know who George Harrison is. You know the main people that's in the Beatles, but you may not know this one member. Many of you, Tanika, she don't want to admit this, but she used to listen to NSYNC back in the day. I won't tell nobody else that. Now, many of you know Justin Timberlake. Ms. Walker, I'm talking to you, all right? But many of you may not know Lance Bass and J.C. Chazes. Back in 2011, there was a guy by the name of Joel Anthony. He's the first name on the roster for the Miami Heat. First name on the roster, last name starts with an A. Now, all of us know LeBron James, but many of us may not know him. See, I don't know about you, but I realize I'm a background singer. Jesus is the headliner, I'm in the background. He runs the show, I do the dance. That's how it works. Y'all remember the Jackson 5? Y'all remember Jackson 5? Yeah, everybody know Michael Jackson. Don't nobody know who Jackie and Marlon are. You might know Tito and Jermaine, you don't even know Jackie. They could have replaced him with another brother you never would have noticed. They're on the Ed Sullivan Show. Hey, you little African-American boy. Marlon can't come. Nobody would know. Come on in. Just do what they do. Okay, I got it. Yeah, good. Okay, I got it. But if Michael's not out front, everybody knows. Uh-huh. You can't replace Michael. See, I can't replace Christ with football. I can't replace Christ with my wife. I can't replace Christ with money or prestige or with fame because it's not going to look right. But if Jesus is out front, I can do a good job being in the background. See, Jesus wants to be the very front of your life. He wants every decision to come through him. He wants to be your filter. I get all these messages on instant message on Facebook. I just joined Facebook for the first time in a month. And I'm about to sit down. I know y'all want to leave. I know y'all got to go eat.
Go ahead.
Okay, well, good. But what I'm trying to tell you is I get these messages. A girl this morning, first thing, for the last 2 weeks, I get a lot of these. I don't know you, first line. I mean, at least 50 of them. But, and she went on, and she was being nice. And she said, if pride come before the fall, she said. And she said, maybe if you wouldn't have been so prideful, this wouldn't have happened. And usually I say, thank you so much. Please pray for me. That's what I say. This morning I said, your first line said, you don't know me. That's true. Because if you knew me, you would know that every decision I make, I consult with Christ first. Pastor can tell you before we made that decision, I talked to him that morning. Talked to two other pastors that morning for counseling, for guidance. I say that to say that Jesus wants to be the filter of every decision you make. Every decision, not just the big ones, because the truth is they're all small to him. He's Jesus. What kind of drapes you get in your house and whether or not to use this doctor or that doctor for your surgery. God wants to be involved with all of them. But our problem is we want to be the star. We want to be out front. We want to make the decision. There's an actor named Kenny Baker. Kenny Baker is a guy that's been in a lot of science fiction movies. He was in this movie called UFO. And in this movie, he had a lot of speaking parts. He was a man. He got to talk, got to move around. People got to see his face. Nobody in this room has ever heard of the movie UFO. If you'll show that poster of the movie, see if any of y'all recognize this poster. No one. No, I will almost guarantee you. Nobody. No, you don't have that on your DVD collection. No one cares about you. I think it grossed 37 cents. I mean, I really think it didn't make a lot of money. But this guy, Kenny Baker, he had a big role in this movie. Well, there was another movie that he was in. You didn't see his face. Oh. Anybody ever heard of this movie?
Yeah.
Okay. One of the highest grossing movies of all time. One of the biggest blockbusters ever made. That little man, Kenny Baker, played R2-D2.
See, many of us, we want to be the star in our small movie instead of being a small part in God's bigger movie. See, God has a big plan for your life and for my life. Your face may not be shown. No one may not realize who you are, but know your role. Stay in your lane. Unify yourself with the Holy Spirit, and God will take you places you never could go. That man didn't make any money from that UFO movie. He probably lost some money in gas driving to work every day. But he is a millionaire because of his small role, because of his role in Star Wars. If I would have said his name, had everybody tell me where you know him from, you would have had to use your phone to Google it. You would have not known who he is. I don't know about you, but I want to play a small part in the movie that God is directing. I want to be a small part of what God is doing. I don't want to be out front. I don't want to be in control. I want to be the one that's unified with the Lord and with the Holy Spirit. How can you tell if somebody is playing that role? How can you tell if someone is unified with Christ? If they are, they exhibit the fruit of the Spirit. Find in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. It says in the book of John chapter 17, I do not pray for these alone. This is Jesus praying for us. He says, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me, and that the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. If I'm not abiding in Christ, then I'm nothing. If I'm abiding in Christ, then I'm something. I'm being used by him. You may ask the question, how do you do this? It sounds good, coach, all this. Be one, unified with the Holy Spirit. How in the world do you get here? Well, in order to do anything in life, you have to take certain steps. In order to be a teacher, I had to take a certain test and go to college. In order to be a coach, there's certain things you have to do. In order to be an ordained elder, there's certain things you have to do. None of us want to go to a physician and they say, oh, how'd you become a doctor? Well, you know, I went online, I Googled how to become a doctor. You know, and I took this course while I was playing a video game. I did it both at the same time. I'm very good at multitasking. Anyway, they printed me out this certificate, and now I'm a neurologist. I'm a neurologist. So we finna open up your brain. I'm gonna do my thing. You ready? No. We would have a problem if the person operating on us didn't go through all the proper steps to be qualified. Some of us know they went through the proper steps and we still have a problem with them because we don't think they're qualified. With that being said, I want to encourage you to apply this message to your life by starting a quiet time. A time every day where you get by yourself and you spend time with God. See, if you do this, you can unify with the Holy Spirit. You can come in line with God, the Father, and the Son. See, those groups I showed you, all the music groups, and we all like different types of music, they rehearse before they perform. They don't just get out there and perform, they rehearse before they perform. A lot of times we're in situations and we act in a way that we shouldn't act because there's been no rehearsal. There's been no time spent with God. There's been no communion. A lot of times we think that the anointing or the talent just comes because God gave it to us. No, anointing comes through consecration, through spending time alone with God. So I'm about to sit down, but if you have something to write with, if you could take notes in your phone, I encourage you to take these notes. That if we don't have a meaningful quiet time, we're running out there with no protection. We're just going about life saying whatever happens, it happens. That's where that term, it is what it is, comes from. That means if it, whatever, I don't know. I don't believe that. I don't believe it is what it is. I believe it is what God says it is. Because see, I am in the group called the Trinity. I'm not a part of the Trinity, but I'm in their group. I'm the biggest fan. I'm in the background while they perform. I'm afraid to let anything else lead this music composition or lead this performance or lead this play. I want Jesus to lead me. I'm not always home. Sometimes I travel. So I believe Jesus is there protecting my family when I'm there and when I'm not. Sometime when I'm traveling, I was in a small plane about a month ago. I was praying the whole time. The guy said, you mumble a lot. I said, in the name of Jesus, 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 in the name of Jesus. Ground, 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 ground. Let us get to the ground, Lord, please. A lot of times we say that we love the Lord, but it's not manifest until we go through trials and tribulations. The first thing we need to do, and I'll be sitting down in less than 5 minutes, proper period. We need to have a proper time of day to spend time with God. Don't give God your leftovers. If I handed you a meal from McDonald's that I had bit off of and ate some of the fries and drank some of the milkshake and said, it was good when I had it, you want the rest? You'd have a problem with that. Don't give God your leftovers. Give him your first. Be great. Just wake up 30 minutes earlier to spend time with God. If not, God can make it so you're in a hospital and you don't have anything but time to spend with God. The next thing is proper preparation. In other words, as I tell the players, get your mind right before you go spend time with God. Confess your sins to him. He was there anyway. He know everything. He was there when you cussed around. He was there when you stole the money. He was there when you lied to everybody's face. He already know. So say, Lord, forgive me so I can go in here and my heart can be right before you. You need a proper place. Yeah, you can't spend time with God with 30 people around, all right? That's a different type of worship service. You need to be by yourself. That may mean you go outside and get in your car in the morning, just sit in the car. It may mean you find a room in the house and everybody else is asleep. It may mean that you shut everything off and you get alone with God. Proper provisions. In other words, have some resources in the room. Because I believe God will speak to you. That when your mind is clear and you don't bring your cell phone in the room and you turn the TV off and the radio off and the gossip is gone, that you can hear God's still, quiet voice. And I'm telling you from experience, he'll speak to you. And you can write those things down so you don't forget them. Proper procedure. Make sure that you don't take your time with Christ for granted. That you have an order to what you're doing. And if you can't do 30 minutes, start with 10 minutes. And I believe God will honor that time. Last thing I'll say before I sit down, Pastor Riley advertised today as National Back to Church Sunday. I know many of you probably thought he made that up, but it is a day, National Back to Church Sunday. That's today. Some of you may have come to church for the first time in a long time. I challenge you to keep coming.
Amen.
You can come to this church, Kenny.
Yes.
Yes, sir, you can come to this church. I didn't know Pastor Riley was as funny as he was. He's a funny man. He's pretty funny. But find a church. There's a bunch of them around here. And let me tell you something, because you may have been hurt by a church. All churches are jacked up because they ran by people.
Right.
Don't let Satan tell you you don't want to go to that church because it's messed up and you know this about that person. Well, you just know too much. Stop learning everything about everybody's life and you'll be all right. All right? You learn too much. Go to church for you, not for the pastor. It's quiet. Go for you.
Amen.
As I sit down, I want you to see this beautiful huddle of the beautiful Escambia Gators.
Right.
What the football team does, y'all give them a hand. Give them a hand. What the football team does, as the band comes on up, the band can come on up. What the football team does is huddle up to get the play. Then they break the huddle and run the play. See, Sunday morning is where we get the play. God gives us instructions. And then you go to your job, you go to your job, you go to your job, and you run the play. See, God wants us all to meet together. And what we learn here on Sundays, he wants us to act out, to apply to our lives during the week. See, your neighbor's going to need a word from the Lord. Your cousin, your mom, your aunt. Is going to need a word. That person you work across the hall from at work, they're going to need a word from the Lord. Well, where are you going to get that word? Through your quiet time and through the huddle on Sunday. God has something amazing for each and every one of us. He wants us to unify with him. Can I help you out? You're not all that by yourself.
Right.
You're not. But if you get on Jesus' team, oh, you'll be a part of something special. I don't know who Joe Anthony is, but playing with LeBron James made him a whole lot better. Marlon and Tito, we don't even know what they're doing right now, but we know everything about Michael Jackson. I want to be a backup dancer in the performance led by Jesus the Christ. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Before I sit down, I want to pray with you. And after we pray, you guys will sing for us.
Yeah.
Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, it says in the book of Hebrews, I believe chapter 25, that we should not fail to assemble together. We were obedient to that today. I thank you for being with us. Thank you for speaking through me this morning. Lord, I pray that there's someone here that does not have a church home, but they can make this their church home. I pray that they go back to that church they used to go to. I pray that they find a body of believers to hang out with every week. We hang out with our favorite sports fans and we root for the same teams, but what about things that are eternal? Our mind will pass away one day along with our body, but our soul will live somewhere forever. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but Lord, if there's someone under the sound of my voice that don't know you, may we get that right today. It's not what you know, it's who you know. And Lord, I want to thank you that you accepted me. Faults and all, shortcomings and everything. You love me unconditionally. Even more so to my wife and my mom and my dad and my children. You love me and you know everything about me and you still love me. Lord, if there's someone here that has not experienced that love, may they get that right today. Bless this house. Bless this time of worship. And may your will continue to be done in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There anyway, he know everything. He was there when you cussed her out. He was there when you stole the money. He was there when you lied to everybody's face. He already know. So say, Lord, forgive me so I can go in here and my heart can be right before you. You need a proper place. Yeah, you can't spend time with God with 30 people around. All right, that's a different type of worship service. Well, you need to be by yourself. That may mean you go outside and get in your car in the morning, just sit in the car. It may mean you find a room in the house and everybody else is asleep. It may mean that you shut everything off and you get alone with God. Proper provisions. In other words, have some resources in the room. Because I believe God will speak to you. That when your mind is clear and you don't bring your cell phone in the room and you turn the TV off and the radio off and the gossip is gone, that you can hear God's still, quiet voice. And I'm telling you from experience, he'll speak to you. And you can write those things down so you don't forget them. Proper procedure. Make sure that you don't take your time with Christ for granted. That you have an order to what you're doing. And if you can't do 30 minutes, start with 10 minutes. And I believe God will honor that time. Last thing I'll say before I sit down, Pastor Riley advertised today as National Back to Church Sunday. I know many of you probably thought he made that up, but it is a day, National Back to Church Sunday. That's today. Some of you may have come to church for the first time in a long time. I challenge you to keep coming.
Amen.
You can come to this church. Kenny?
Yes.
Yes, sir. You can come to this church. I didn't know Pastor Riley was as funny as he was. He's a funny man. He's pretty funny. But find a church. There's a bunch of them around here. And let me tell you something, because you may have been hurt by a church. All churches are jacked up because they ran by people.
Right.
Don't let Satan tell you you don't want to go to that church because it's messed up and you know this about that person. Well, you just know too much. Stop learning everything about everybody's life and you'll be all right. All right? You learn too much. Go to church for you, not for the pastor. It's quiet. Go for you. As I sit down, I want you to see this beautiful huddle of the beautiful Escambia Gators.
Right.
What the football team does, y'all give them a hand, give them a hand. What the football team does as the band comes on up, the band can come on up. What the football team does is huddle up to get the play. Then they break the huddle and run the play. See, Sunday morning is where we get the play. God gives us instructions. And then you go to your job, you go to your job, you go to your job, and you run the play. See, God wants us all to meet together, and what we learn here on Sundays, he wants us to act out, to apply to our lives during the week. See, there's your neighbor's gonna need a word from the Lord. Your cousin, your mom, your aunt is gonna need a word. That person you work across the hall from at work, they're gonna need a word from the Lord. Well, where are you gonna get that word? Through your quiet time and through the huddle on Sunday. God has something amazing for each and every one of us. He wants us to unify with him. Can I help you out? You're not all that by yourself.
Right.
You're not. But if you get on Jesus' team, oh, you'll be a part of something special. I don't know who Joe Anthony is, but playing with LeBron James made him a whole lot better. Marlon and Tito, we don't even know what they're doing right now, but we know everything about Michael Jackson. I want to be a backup dancer in the performance led by Jesus the Christ. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Before I sit down, I want to pray with you. And after we pray, you guys will sing for us. Yeah. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, it says in the book of Hebrews, I believe chapter 25, that we should not fail to assemble together. We were obedient to that today. I thank you for being with us. Thank you for speaking through me this morning. Lord, I pray that there's someone here that does not have a church home, but they can make this their church home. I pray that they go back to that church they used to go to. I pray that they find a body of believers to hang out with every week. We hang out with our favorite sports fans and we root for the same teams, but what about things that are eternal? Our mind will pass away one day along with our body, but our soul will live somewhere forever. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but Lord, if there's someone under the sound of my voice that don't know you, may we get that right today. It's not what you know, it's who you know. And Lord, I want to thank you that you accepted me. Faults and all, shortcomings and everything. You love me unconditionally. Even more so than my wife and my mom and my dad and my children. You love me and you know everything about me and you still love me. Lord, if there's someone here that has not experienced that love, may they get that right today. Bless this house, bless this time of worship, and may your will continue to be done in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.